Let's get a very special guest on the show. Manish Sonthalia, he's head of equities for portfolio management services at Motilal Oswal Asset Management Company, joins us right now on the show with his thoughts. Manish, really appreciate you taking the time out. Good morning. Thanks so much for joining in. You know, if we juxtapose what's happening in the macros versus the micros, there's a bit of a dichotomy here. However, I just thought, Manish, that last week or the last 2 weeks, we've got a couple of fairly decent ticks on the macro front as well. While albeit lower than expected, but the GST collections did seem like a number which is on the mend. The GDP numbers looked fairly strong as well. How does all of this portend for what the markets do over the course of the next 12 months?
So, starting with the numbers, you know, the quarterly numbers that just went by, on the quarter that just went by, were decent enough. I don't think there was any major disappointment except for, you know, the corporate banks. Of course, there was disappointment. It was expected to be disappointing. But if you leave aside the corporate BFSI space, I mean, I believe that the numbers were perfectly okay. And there's going to be a build-up on the profits as we move into 2019 numbers, so that's taken care of. I think in terms of macros, only the oil price and the rupee would matter at this given point in time. I would believe that GST numbers, you know, which were something like 5,000 crores or short than the previous month, was okay. I mean, there's not too much to worry about on that front. As well as the GDP tick was higher, so that was a positive surprise. I think the key point to note out here is that if oil moves to $70, we could see the Nifty cross 12,000. And because that's going to have a rub-off impact on the rupee, and the rupee being now at closer to 69, there's not too much of a room to fall further from these levels. And this would attract FII flows, you know, try to invest in Indian markets, where there has been some decent correction, at least in the larger, broader market per se. So I would look at the markets more positively at this given point in time for a couple of reasons. Oil has come off its highs. Rupee has depreciated significantly. I don't think there's too much of depreciation possible from these levels. And, you know, put these things together, it's a perfect recipe that, you know, I think the market should be positive from these levels.
Mm. Hi Manish, good morning. Well, clearly the focus remains on the macro with regard to the crude prices, or for that matter the movement in rupee. At least the last few days have been good on both these parameters, but this week now the focus also shifts to RBI meet, which is lined up for June 6. What are you watching out? Do you expect any sort of rate hike in this meeting, or you expect the rate hike to come in the month of August?
So I think the monsoon season should be watched out for. I don't think there is too much of a possibility of a rate hike just yet. Maybe, you know, we'll have a status quo even day after tomorrow. But given how Kharif plays out, the Kharif season plays out, we'll broadly be taking a call on the rates sometime in August. I think over the next 12 months, 50 bips or thereabouts should be what should be built in. I think the markets are already factoring in a 50 bips rise from these levels over the course of next 12 months. Whether it happens tomorrow or August, we need to figure out. But I think there's more a chance of a status quo rather than a hike per se. But even if a hike is about 25 basis point, it should be okay. I don't think markets should be very negatively surprised even if it comes through, because there has been some decent correction in markets, and most of the negatives that are there prevalent today would have got priced in.
Manish, if I were to look at the correction that, you know, one has seen in 2018, well, the large caps are still, you know, where we started this year at. The major correction that has come in has been in the broader markets. And as we speak, it's the broader markets are finding it very difficult to remain in that positive territory. Midcap as well as small cap index has once again slipped into the red territory. Do you think this could be the year of large caps and not the mid caps? And if you're not of that view, do you think there is value in mid-caps after the correction that we've seen?
Yeah, so there's no doubt that there's value in mid-caps today as opposed to what it was, let's say, a year back or 2 years back. See, we need to understand the thing in perspective. Post-demonetization, GST, a lot of money has come into the mid-cap and the small-cap, right? And due to, you know, the reclassification on SEBI's part, you know, what was a large-cap has become a mid-cap. Based on the reclassification, what was a mid-cap has become a small-cap. Now, you have a lot of money which has come into the mid and small-caps, and you are supposed to adjust all your funds within a cutoff date, and that is actually exaggerating the fall in many of the mid-cap and the small-cap names. Of course, there has been a PE multiple contraction due to deteriorating macros, etc. But you know, 60% of the mid-cap stocks have lost more than 20%. I mean, this sort of a thing I don't think that the numbers are that bad as far as the quarterly numbers per se are concerned. There's been some correction on PE multiples, but most of the thing has been due to technical factors like reclassification of the categories, the large caps, the mid caps, and the small caps. Mm-hmm. So,
okay, sorry, you are making your point, finishing your point, Manish?
Yeah, so you know, once we get off this cutoff date, whatever that cutoff date is, you know, 30th of June or thereabouts, you'll see a reversion back to mean. So much of money is actually flowing to the large caps that you'll create excesses on the large caps. So from that point of view, you'll see some decent correction in the large caps once the cutoff date passes. And then when you have created so much of a vacuum in the mid-cap and the small-cap space, again, you'll see a reversion to the mean. Now that you would not see too much of selling coming due to technical factors. Of course, fundamentals will determine the course of the mid and small caps in any case, but you won't see too much of a selling coming in through technical factors. I mean, that again is quite evident to happen once that cutoff date gets over. So whatever that cutoff date is, we'll see reversion to the mean on both the large cap and the mid and the small cap space.
Manish, the last time that we spoke on Alpha Moguls, you were fairly constructive or hopeful of this move from the unorganized to the organized, primarily to GST. Now, a few managements that we spoke to, Manish, in quarter four seem to suggest that the parallel market is not only existing but thriving. The whole move hasn't happened at the pace that people anticipated, and were hoping that the e-way bill probably could do the trick as well. Have you personally been disappointed with the swiftness in which this would have happened, or were your estimates of a slow, gradual shift, and therefore the shift is happening as per how you anticipated?
No, it is happening. There are two things to this. See, the GST rate on many of the consumption names have come down from 28 to 18%. So you would have seen many of the consumption names has actually seen a volume uptick. Now, you could say that part of this uptick was due to GST, but there's also a second reason. Given the fact that there's price elasticity on demand, and 28% coming down to 18% would have triggered some sort of a volume uptick. So the last quarter, which is the fourth quarter, and the first quarter would see a very low base effect when we compare it on a YOY basis. So this quarter again you're going to see some very decent numbers in terms of a volume uptick, but part of this could be due to the fact that GST rates on many of the consumption names have come down. So there's a volume uptick due to price elasticity on demand. The real test on whether there is a shift from unorganized to organized is going to be felt from the third quarter onwards. So first two quarters, till about September, you're going to see volume uptick, but that could be attributed to price elasticity on demand. The third quarter and the fourth quarter is where the real test would be. My sense is, doing some ground checks, that it's happening. The shift from unorganized to organized is happening, albeit at a very slow pace. And now that e-way bill has also kicked in, we need to see how effective this whole pickup in the shift would happen. And of course, GST numbers on a monthly basis would also substantiate whether the shift is actually happening or not. So it's a wait and watch. I wouldn't rule out that nothing has happened in the quarter gone by. There is movement, there is a shift which is happening, although very slowly and may not be noticeable immediately, but things are playing out as expected.
Mm. You know, the standout for me, Manish, in that conversation was also about the possibilities of, or why is it that the markets would be wary of the kind of volume growth numbers that these companies have shown. You've explained it in part about how the prices coming off led to the volume growth numbers as well. But do you believe there is a prolonged period of, may not be 15%, but a prolonged period of fairly decent volume growth numbers that we are in for the FMCG space by and large?
110%. First of all, an inflationary environment works best for staples, the FMCG companies, because not only volume growth, you also tend to take price increase, and part of which flows into your EBITDA and your PAT. And second, we are coming off a very low base. I mean, last 3 years, broadly, the FMCG space, barring a few exceptions here and there, have not done anything because it was all about volume growth. There was hardly any pricing power. One needs to see whether the raw material cost increase gets mitigated through price increase, and that would actually show what sort of a pricing power these individual companies have. Valuations have corrected, volume growth is here to come, shift from unorganized to organized is happening. It's in a sweet spot. The consumer staple space remain the favorites for the next 1 year.
Okay, in fact, the earnings from this space definitely did not disappoint, this time around for the fourth quarter. Pull up HDFC Bank, remember that's the stock which is in focus. It's now in the red, and let's not forget, it gained nearly 5% last week, and now as we speak, HDFC Bank is down 1.5%. Manish, a word on the banking space. How should one play this? Private versus PSU, is there any value that you're finding in the PSU banking pack considering the sort of correction that one has seen? And also a word on the Mint report today, which suggests that government is considering merger of banks like Bank of Baroda, IDBI Bank, Oriental Bank and Central Bank. Do you think consolidation is the way forward for the PSU banking pack?
So I think it's private sector banks all along. One needs to be a brave heart to actually look into these PSU names. I mean, there is no doubt that there is value, but the whole space is having so many problems. It would require too much of courage to actually build in position at these levels. I think I would wait for some more time to get clarity when the NPA cycle would have actually peaked, and then maybe take a call on the space. Till then, it is about MFI, which is going to be in a sweet spot. The NPA levels are coming down significantly. It's an election year, so the rural space would be doing good. The private sector banking space, there is a shift away from the PSU banks to the private sector banks, NBFCs. And here I would focus more on the retail lenders as opposed to the corporate lenders. Coming to consolidation, I think government is of the opinion that we should have large PSU banks as opposed to too many PSU banks, and the merger that is being thought about in terms of Bank of Baroda taking over or merging three more PSU banks would be a step in that direction. Of course, it would come with its own set of challenges, the worker strength or the labor strength out there, the cost is to income ratio, the capital adequacy, because the names that are being touted to get merged in, let's say, Bank of Baroda, don't have a very happy picture as far as the balance sheet is concerned. So there would be challenges, and I think, the full brunt of it will have to be taken by Bank of Baroda on its balance sheet. So once this new entity emerges, then there would be clarity on how the growth and the NPA levels would play out. But till about the time these banks get merged into BOB, I think there will be some more haircuts that needs to be taken on this front.